page 270 of the Book of Common Prayer. As you are able, please stand. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, O Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts whereby you have given us life and immortality through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel according to St. Matthew. When Jesus and his disciples had come near to Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them ahead of him. When people who were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus had entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in a turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for the act of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. On this day he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed as King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palm along his way. Let these branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns with you in glory with the Holy Spirit now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Let us go forth in peace.
Thank you.
Calvary paid, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Struck him, and some slapped him, saying, Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, a servant girl came to him and said,
"You also believe as the Galilean."
But he denied it before all of them, saying,
"I do not know what you are talking about."
When he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders,
"This man was with Jesus of Nazareth."
Again he denied it with an oath,
"I do not know the man."
After a while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter,
"Certainly you are also one of them, for your acts has betrayed you."
Then he began to curse, and he swore an oath,
"I do not know the man."
At that moment, the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." And Peter went out and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the high priest and the elders. He said,
"I have sinned by betraying innocent blood."
But they said,
"What is that to us? See you yourself."
Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, Judas departed and went and hanged himself. But the chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said,
"It is not lawful to have any treasure."
After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the Field of Blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah, "And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of one on whom a price had been set, on whom some of the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me." Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus said,
"You say so."
But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him,
"Do you not hear how many accusations they have made against you?"
But he gave him no answer, not even a single charge. So the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner to the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them,
"Whom do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Messiah?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them,
"Which of the two do you want me to release for you?"
And they said,
"Barabbas."
Pilate said to them,
"Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?"
All of them said,
"Let him be crucified."
Then he asked,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
Let him be crucified.
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves."
Then the people as a whole answered, So they released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him, mocking him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on his head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they found a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. As you're able, please stand. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when Jesus tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head they put a charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You destroy the Son of the Temple, and kill him in 3 days, and save yourself. You are the Son of God. Come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying,
"He saved others.
With Jesus also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice, that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, once one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But others said, then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. The earth shook, and rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now, when the centurion and those who were with him, who were keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
Many women were also there, looking on from a great distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee and had provided for him. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who also was a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body, and wrapping it in a clean cloth, he laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, that is, the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, conspiracy. You know what conspiracies are, or the theories of conspiracies? They're all around us. We're surrounded by them. Conspiracy theories have these points. They're notions, ideas that are unproven, and that's why they're called theories and not laws. Second, they're used to explain the unknown, to give us answers to the mysteries, the difficulties that face us. For example, in our time, we had a great conspiracy called Asian flu conspiracy or Chinese flu. Third, conspiracy theories usually are based on fear of the unknown. Will naming that event help us to control it? Fourth, conspiracy theories often cause great difficulty. Just look at what happened when we began calling the pandemic Asian flu or Chinese flu. Look at the prejudice, the harassment that happened to Asians, people of Pacific Island descent. Fifth, conspiracy theories are not either from the left or from the right. They're not liberal or conservative. They are just human. And that leads me to the final point about conspiracy theories. Conspiracy theories have been with us forever. Or they've been with us for as long as human beings were telling stories to try to explain the unknown. When I was thinking about this sermon, I came up with a title for it in my mind. The title was The Ultimate Conspiracy Theory. The Ultimate Conspiracy Theory. Because that's what I thought this was. This story that you just joined me in telling, the story of Jesus' arrest and trial and death. That story is a conspiracy. Then I thought about the real, the ultimate, the real ultimate conspiracy theory. And namely it is this. It is that human beings are no good. Human beings are worthless. That's been around for a long time. It began as people began to ask themselves, if God, who is good, created everything and called it good, then why is there evil in the world? Why is there pain? Why is there death? Why are there any of these things? And they struggled with it, human beings. And they said it must be because human beings are no good. They're worthless. Because if God created everything good and God saw human behavior for what it was, then God must have become angry with humankind. God must have changed God's mind about what human beings were like. And stories got told about this. Stories, just as humankind always told stories. There was the story of Adam and Eve. A snake got put into the story, a serpent, to help the story along. Surely Adam and Eve were tempted by a serpent. And there were millions of stories about why human beings were no good. And we keep on creating them right up to the present moment. I think you'll find them all around you. And those stories include ways in which we, the worthless people, can appease God, can make God begin to like us at least a little. There is truth, though, and the truth is this: God loves us. God might be disappointed with human behavior, but that does not mean that God sees us as worthless, no good. And the Hebrew scriptures make this point loud and clear. There are two places in Hebrew scripture, to begin with, that Jesus summarized as the summary of the law. The law, the only law, he said, that supersedes all other laws. The first part came from Deuteronomy, the sixth chapter, verses 4-5, where it was written, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength." And then in the book of Leviticus, the 19th chapter, these words: "You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against your neighbor, but you shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. I am the Lord." Jesus summarized that as the only law that supersedes all other laws. The prophet Micah would underline all of this when he talked about the sacrifices that people were offering in the hopes that they could appease God. And Micah said, "God has already shown you what is necessary. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God?" In other words, the summary of the law. And there is still greater truth that we know. The truth that God sent God's Son, Jesus the Christ, as a human being, as one of us, to come among us, to show us that we are indeed loved, that we are God's beloved, and to show us how God's beloved are to behave, are to act. You heard this story over and over. In this church, you've heard it in the scriptures of the last year. You'll hear it again in the scriptures of the coming year. You'll hear it if you read the Bible day after day in your life. You'll hear those words come to life, that you are God's beloved. And now we come to the story that we just shared in telling. that story of a conspiracy. And it wasn't just the conspiracy of Judas and the religious officials. They're just a subplot to the larger conspiracy. Judas is nothing but a pawn in the larger plan. The conspiracy is simply this. Get rid of this troublemaker, Jesus. Kill him. He is a threat to religion. Or so they said as they understood religion. What had Jesus done to be such a threat? Well, he disregarded the Sabbath, they said. I think what he really did was to redirect the meaning of Sabbath day. They said he ignored the law. But Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. And he showed that, for example, when they brought a woman to him who had been caught in the very act of adultery, which the law said required that she be stoned to death. Remember that story? Jesus wrote in the dirt and said, well, let the one of you who has never sinned be throw the first stone at her. And they all left. That was the fulfillment of the law. No matter what anyone had done, even one caught in adultery, Jesus said, there is love, there is forgiveness. They said, this man, Jesus, claimed God as his father. And he did. He also performed, they said, many acts that were just unheard of in his time. Healing the blind, healing lepers, even raising a man named Lazarus from death. That was especially troubling to the religious leaders. There was more than they could do. And they even wanted to have Lazarus put to death along with Jesus to get rid of this sign of what Jesus had done. Jesus sealed his fate with stories that he told, stories that were really directed at those religious officials. For example, he told them the story of a group of wicked tenants who had been given land to grow grapes on and to build a wine press in. And when the grapes were ripe and when they were made into wine, the owner of the vineyard sent his people there to get his share of the profits, and they killed them. And finally he sent his son, saying, surely they'll respect the son. And they killed him and threw his body outside the vineyard. And the Pharisees, in the words from Matthew's gospel, knew that this story was about them. They said this, when they realized that Jesus was speaking about them, they wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowd because the people regarded him as a prophet. Finally, Jesus also did not deny the claims that people made that he was a king. And that was probably the biggest thing the religious officials could bring to the Roman occupying government. A king would be a threat to the religious order, the civil order, the order that they wanted to have kept so that they could keep their good thing going. And so they demanded the Roman government crucify Jesus because their law wouldn't allow this. And it was all based on this conspiracy theory and their fear of this man. None of it was based on the truth. the truth that Jesus was the Son of God, was the ultimate King. They thought they solved the problem. However, we know the rest of the story. We know what happens in the celebration all this week and next Sunday. That God raised Jesus from death. That the worst human beings could do to the Son of God was foiled by God himself. And in so doing, God gave life to us and underlined the fact that we are God's beloved. We are the people dearly beloved of God. And don't let anyone ever tell you anything different. Join me in our prayers for our world, our lives, as the followers of Jesus.
We will be using Form 3. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve.
Let your name be glorified by all people.
We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Jennifer, our bishop, Bill, our priest in charge, for our companion diocese, Bourne, the Sudan, and their bishop Reuben, Brasilia, and their bishop Mauricio, for the people of Haiti and their bishop Zache. In our Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the province of the Episcopal Church of South Sudan. We pray for St. John's Lafayette, the Reverend Dr. Bradley Pace, all our diocesan partners, all baptized, all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That we may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for Joe, our president, Eric, our governor, Thomas, our mayor, and all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
Let our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who are hospitalized, including Mary Jo Lee. For those in convalescent centers or at home, Nancy Ashley, Susan Buco, Teddy Fada, Sonia Hurley, Candy McPherson, Barbara Moffitt, Pat Schroeder, and Carol Smalley. For our men and women in the armed forces, especially Audrey McMillan Cole, Chastain Gardner, Jessica Halliday, Brandon Halliwell, Greg, Chad Hewlett, Micah Jones, Chris Call, Brian Casper, Amanda Conover McAllister, Reed Ratliff, Travis Reed, Allison Woodruff, Ethan Losh, and Zach Webb. For those who are homeless, unemployed, or underemployed, and all those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to all the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy, especially Andy Greenlee, brother-in-law of Sonia Burton.
We're killed in the recent tornadoes in Arkansas, Mississippi, and Alabama. We're all killed in shootings in schools and stores and on our streets. For those who die in wars, especially in the Ukraine.
For Jan Halliday, the wife of Reverend Richard Halliday.
We pray for those on our daily printed prayer list, Mike and Beverly Badgley, Sherry Ballinger, and Robert and Diane Vance. We pray for those who celebrate birthdays or anniversaries this week, including Marty Godleski and Bishop Smalley. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, including those in our printed prayer list, either silently or aloud.
Lord Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, help us to follow you in the way that leads to Calvary as we walk daily with you on the way of the cross. We ask this in your name. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord is always with you.
And also with you.
On these days of Lent, we have been invited to fast or have a sacrificial meal and to bring the savings for the relief of others in need. As any of you have these offerings of the sacrificial meals, I invite you to bring them forward. Deb will hold it for us. Let us with gladness present the other offerings of our and oblations of our life and labor to God.
Thank you.
that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Bow down before the Lord. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold us, your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
All right.
From Trinity Congregation.
It is Pat or Diane?
Yes, I just wanted everyone to know that we had 13 people come yesterday to make these lovely little palm crosses. I certainly hope as you take one, take an extra one and mail it to someone that you think could use it or maybe hasn't been thought of. So these special little blessed crosses. I know that when my mother passed, I opened her top drawer and the card from the church from Palm Sunday with the little cross in the floor center was laying right on the top where we would all see it. So it does mean a great deal to people. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane.
There are a bunch of cards that need to be signed, and please do take the time to sign them for people that are not here. So, appreciate it. Thank you very much.
And last one.
Yeah.
We were hoping to have this as the last day for reservations for Bishop's Lunch, which will be on the 16th, the last Sunday that you will be preaching here. So please catch me in the coffee hour, and if you want to make reservations, please let me know.
It is our custom to make the music that Christy offers a part of our worship. So please remain seated while Christy gives us some closing words of music. Rejoicing in the power of God's presence with us.
Thanks be to God.